Welcome to St Margaret's Church, Frizinghall. It's great to have you with us, whether you've been attending church for a while or you're just curious about what Christianity is all about. You are very much welcome. Today is Palm Sunday. We'll be remembering the day when Jesus rode a donkey into Jerusalem as the humble king, not like everyone expected of him.
Because of that, we'll be making some palm crosses for this service for you to stick in your windows at home. So you will need an A4 piece of paper and a pair of scissors. If you want to join in with this activity, feel free to pause the video to grab these now.
So, we do have some notices today, which is exciting. Do you know where they are?
No, I don't know where they are. Notices! Notices!
There they are. It's okay, You don't need to call for them. Here we go. So, Matt kindly told us last week about the Frizinghall Tree of Hope in the church garden, where you can decorate an egg to put on it. If you still need an egg to make this tree as bright and beautiful as possible, let us know via the easter@smcf-church.org.uk email. And you could put your decorated egg on the tree this Friday, Good Friday, between 12 and 3 p.m. At that time the church will be open for prayer and the garden will be open too, which is coming on nicely and looking excellent.
Today we have the first in a series of services for Holy Week and Easter with our teaching led by Molly and Graham Dow. Molly will lead us in a meditative service for Good Friday and Graham will teach us on Easter Sunday and the following Sunday. Welcome Molly and Graham. Today the church will be open for quiet meditative services. Today's service will be Holy Communion at 4 p.m. Apart from next week, 4 p.m. will be the usual time for the services.
But next week, on Easter Sunday, we will have a service of Holy Communion with a baptism. Thomas Temple is being baptised and that will be part of our Easter celebration at 11 a.m. instead of 4 p.m. Please do come to celebrate together. We expect to be able to accommodate as many of us as want to come. But so we avoid turning anyone away, Denise is going to maintain a list of those wanting to come. So either grab her at church later today or alternatively contact her via text, WhatsApp or use the church email. When we are full and unable to take anyone else, we will put our message out there. So go on, get going! Be quick! Go, go, go! Send a text! Catch it, whatever you need to do.
We are also looking for a new minister to help and support us as a church. Do read your niece's letter carefully.
And now, about those palm crosses. Let's learn how to make some.
Normally, when we're in church in person, we would give you a palm cross that looks like this. And hopefully next year we will be able to give you one. But today we are going to make one that looks like this. And we're going to hold it up to worship Jesus in today's service. And we're going to put it in our windows this week. And maybe you could decorate it for Easter Day. All you're going to need is a piece of plain paper, and A4 will be fine, and a pair of scissors. And if you're a child, you might want to get an adult to help you when you need to use them. What you need to do is get the top corner of the piece of paper and fold it in so that it lines up with the edge of the paper and fold it. Then you need to take this corner and fold it in here so that it lines up with that bit of the paper. And so you should have a thing that looks a bit like a house, that kind of shape. Then you need to take the top bit of this page and fold it here. Fold it in half. Then you need to take this little bit of the paper and fold it over like that. So you should have it looking like this. And then you need to take your scissors and cut down the middle of your paper. And then if you fold out the tallest strip of paper, you should have a cross that looks like this. So there it is. After the service, put the these up in your windows to show that we belong to Christ. And for Easter Sunday, you can decorate them with bright colours and put them in the window to celebrate Jesus' victory over sin and death. But we can use them now in our worship, lifting them up high and waving them to praise the Lord and honour King Jesus. So let's do that now as we have our first song of worship.
Make way, make way,
make way, make way,
for the King of Kings,
for the King of Kings.
Make way, make way,
make way, make way,
for the King of Kings,
for the King of Kings.
Make way, make way, for Christ the King, King splendor arise.
Let's say sorry to God. Father God, we are sorry for our unbelief and the way we often doubt that you are at work in our lives, that we don't make time for you and give you our first fruits, for how we ignore your promptings when we know it's the right thing to do. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. We are sorry for our greed and selfishness, our impatience and irritability, for our judgments and lack of mercy towards others, for the times we talk about or mislead others with our words when we don't know what it's like to walk in someone else's shoes. Father, forgive us, save us and help us. In the book of Micah, there is a verse where he talks about how God forgives our sins. Who is a God like you, who pardons sins and forgives the transgressions of the remnant of his inheritance? You do not stay angry forever, but delight to show mercy. You will again have compassion on us. You will tread our sins underfoot and hurl all our iniquities into the depths of the sea. We thank you, Father God, for your forgiveness. Amen.
So Kim and I are definitely asking ourselves at the moment, Lord, what are you doing? As you guys know, we've been hoping to move to Denmark this summer, And it's kind of been contingent on getting a visa for Kim and raising enough financial support. So the financial support is coming in, but it's coming in regularly, but probably a little bit slower than we were hoping for. And we were just told today that the visa that we hoped or expected to hear about this week or the week after, we now told when I called the Danish government that we probably won't hear until the end of May. So then that throws up all sorts of questions about, well, are we moving? Are we not? How much can we plan for when we don't know if Kim is going to get the visa and how quickly the money is going to come in? And yeah, and I'm thinking, God, you seem to say at least that we had freedom to go and you could really just help us by getting us the visa quickly, letting the money come in really quickly, and that will kind of give us the peace that, right, we are definitely going. Or you could give us a quick no on the visa and have no support coming in, financial support, and then we would know, okay, we're probably not going. Instead, we kind of just left in this limbo, and it's really, really hard to kind of not know if we're coming and going. So we're definitely wondering, what is God doing right now?
The time of Passover was drawing near, and Jesus and his disciples traveled toward Jerusalem with a crowd of fascinated people in tow. The people following Jesus had heard of or seen the many wonderful works he had done, and they were eager to see what he would do once he arrived in the great city of Jerusalem. On their journey, they came across two small towns near the Mount of Olives. As they approached, Jesus sent two of his disciples ahead on a special mission. Jesus told the two disciples, "When you enter the next village, you will find a donkey's young colt there that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it to me. If anyone stops you and asks what you are doing, tell them, 'It is needed for the Lord of all.'" The two disciples followed Jesus' instructions and made their way to the village. As the two men walked to the village, they discussed all that Jesus had told them. And before long, they arrived at the village. Immediately after entering the village, they came across a donkey and her colt, just as Jesus said they would. Continuing to follow Jesus' instructions, they began to untie the colt so that they could bring it back to Jesus. As the disciples worked to untie the colt, the owners approached them and said, "What are you doing?" The disciples replied, "We need this donkey for the Lord of all." The owners allowed the disciples to take the colt, and they brought it back to Jesus. After returning, the disciples put their cloaks on the donkey's back and placed Jesus onto the animal. As Jesus rode the donkey, people ran out to meet him, placing palm leaves and spreading their cloaks out in front of him on the road. Jesus continued his journey, and as the road began to go down to the Mount of Olives, the whole crowd of disciples began to praise God joyfully, in loud voices, for all the miracles they had seen. "Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest." Some of the religious leaders had come out to watch the procession, and they grew angry over the outpouring of joy and praise at Jesus' arrival. They called out to Jesus, saying, "Teacher, you must order your followers at once to stop saying these things." But Jesus responded, "Listen to me. If my followers were silenced, the very stones would break out and praise me." As Jesus came near to Jerusalem, he saw the great city and began to weep. Jesus said to the inhabitants, If only you had known that today was the day your Messiah had come, and that he came to bring peace. But you will not understand who I am, and why I have come. Because of this, your enemies will overtake you and destroy this great city. The people of Jerusalem would only understand after his death that Jesus had come to save them from their sins.
Hello, it's very good to be with you all again. Thank you for having me. Now, today is Palm Sunday, a day associated in my mind with processions through the streets. I'm thinking especially of Coventry, where we used to live, and where there was a procession in the city centre between our church, Holy Trinity, and the cathedral every year on Palm Sunday. Now, one thing about processions is that almost all the people who take part in them usually know what the procession is about and what it is hoped to achieve. Some events and times of our lives are like that. We know, or think we know, what life is all about for us, what we're doing and why. We may even know what God is doing and where it's leading. But there are other times when life feels confusing and we don't know what God is doing or why. Perhaps we can learn something from that first Palm Sunday. It was at the time of the Jewish Passover when the Jews celebrated God's rescuing them from slavery in Egypt and looked forward to a time when he would rescue them from Roman occupation and re-establish them as a free nation with their own king, who would be a descendant of the famous King David. There was always a sense of excitement and hope. This particular year, Jesus and his disciples had arrived at Bethany after a long journey from Galilee to be in Jerusalem for Passover. John tells us that Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead, and probably some people had already heard about this and come to see him for themselves. Anyway, a crowd has gathered to greet them. So Jesus, his disciples and the crowd set off on the road down the valley and across to Jerusalem, making a kind of procession. Jesus is riding on a borrowed colt. It was a fairly noisy procession. Some people were breaking branches off trees and spreading these branches and their clothes in the road in front of Jesus. And many of them were shouting, "Hosanna to the Son of David!" As in any crowd of people, their thoughts and attitudes about what they were doing will have been very varied. But unusually in this procession, only one person really knew why they were there and what it was all about from God's point of view. So let's look more closely. Firstly, at Jesus. He was probably the one and only person there who did know what it was all about. He had planned it and he knew what he was doing. We know that he had planned it because he had obviously made arrangements sometime beforehand about the donkey's colt. So when the disciples arrived at the village to collect it, they were to say, "The Lord's needs it," and the owners would then know who it was for and let them take the colt. Now there's a prophecy from Zechariah, perhaps in Jesus' mind, about Israel's king coming sitting on a donkey's colt. Maybe Jesus had this in mind. Anyone in the crowd who remembered this prophecy might well think that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem intending to be enthroned as king. Was that what Jesus wanted people to realise? It would obviously be an exciting thought. But Jesus knew that he was going to Jerusalem not to be enthroned, but to be killed and then to be raised from death. He knew that this procession fitted into God's plan to save the world and defeat evil. But no one else there seemed to realise all of this. So what did the crowd think it was all about? Well, there were lots of people there, and probably some of them were more clued up about Jesus than others. Many, perhaps most of them, would know of Jesus' reputation as a prophet, teacher, and healer. so they'd be glad to welcome him. And because it was Passover time, and because of his riding into Jerusalem on a colt, some of them may have been wondering if he really could be the long-awaited Messiah and King of Israel. Some were cutting down branches or throwing their cloaks in the road for Jesus to ride over as a way of honouring him. Some were cheering him as son of David, meaning a king. And Jesus was indeed worthy of all this celebration. They were getting something right in that Jesus was Messiah and king, but what they hadn't grasped at all was what kind of king he was. And some were shouting Hosanna, a shout of praise, which means something like, save now. Now they were right in that Jesus was coming to save or rescue. Probably most of them, what they wanted was freedom from Roman occupation, that kind of freedom. So if that was what Jesus planned to bring, they'd be delighted. Was this going to be it? Perhaps there were others in the crowd who were not at all sure that he was the Messiah, but liked his teaching and healing, so they were prepared to come and cheer him on. After all, they could always slip away quickly if there was trouble or if it all came to nothing. Or they could say, oh, it's nothing to do with me, Gov. Or, I only went to see what was happening. But basically, it was a friendly, supportive crowd cheering Jesus and welcoming him to Jerusalem. They won't all have been thinking or expecting the same things, of course. Luke tells us that there were some Pharisees among the crowd who were telling people to stop shouting their hosannas. Maybe some of them wondered if this procession meant that he might be going to do something significant towards their freedom. But if so, they were probably thinking in terms of their own political rescue from the Romans. They didn't realise that God was going to achieve salvation for the world, fulfilling his plan not through military or political victory, but through Jesus' suffering, death and resurrection. None of them knew that he was coming to die. So many of them were partly right and partly wrong in different ways and what they thought was going on. But they were there and they cheered Jesus on, and that was good. So what about the disciples? On their journey together from Galilee to Jerusalem, Jesus had tried to prepare them for what lay ahead. He had told them that he was going to Jerusalem to die, to be killed by the authorities, but that this would not be failure, a disastrous defeat for God. It was all part of God's plan. But the disciples didn't really understand. Like most of the nation of Israel, they thought that the whole point of the Messiah was to conquer, to drive out the Romans, liberate God's people, the Jews, and reign over them as king. Perhaps they thought that this processional entry to Jerusalem meant that Jesus was going to be that sort of king after all. Or had they conveniently forgotten what he'd said about suffering and dying? We don't know. However, they had been with Jesus, travelling around with him for 2 or 3 years. So they stayed with him, going along with what he had arranged and decided, including this procession, even though they hadn't really grasped the plan. Peter and Judas must both have been there with the others. What did they make of it? We shall look at them again on Good Friday. We just don't know exactly what was going on in the minds of any of the disciples. The Bible doesn't tell us. We don't know how much or how little they understood. But they trusted Jesus and they stayed with him. And that's the important thing. So how might all this have something to say to us? Well, like the disciples on Palm Sunday, there are times for all of us when we know that something is going on, perhaps something quite significant, but we aren't sure what it is or what God is going to do about it. Sometimes we think we do know what's going on, but we may not have understood things quite rightly. Maybe we've prayed for what we think God wants in the situation, but God hasn't answered our prayers in the way we expect. That's a bit like the crowd on Palm Sunday who asked God to save now, Hosanna, And he did save, but not in the way they had expected and hoped for. Similar things are true at the moment for us in this time of the coronavirus. I don't know about you, but I have prayed a lot for God to bring an end to the pandemic. Preferably to end it quickly and in a way that brings glory to him. Early on, I really expected him to do something dramatic, but he hasn't done it, at least not yet. I don't know just what plan God has in mind. Now, like the disciples on Palm Sunday, I have been following Jesus for quite a long time, and I have found him to be trustworthy and wise. So in this present situation, like them, though I don't really know what God's doing, I'm planning to stay with him without knowing what he's going to do, but trusting him to have a good plan and to work it out well. That's what the 12 disciples did. They stuck with Jesus even through the next frightening week, though they had a wobble and ran away on Maundy Thursday when Jesus was arrested. And Judas didn't stick with Jesus all the way either. But eventually it all worked out marvellously, and 11 out of the 12 of them discovered Jesus and his plan to be far more wonderful than they could possibly have imagined. We shall hear that more about that next weekend at Easter and beyond. It's going to be wonderful for the disciples and for the whole world. On Palm Sunday, Jesus knew full well what he was doing, even though others didn't. The disciples did the best they could by sticking with him, trusting him even when they didn't understand. And the challenge to us is to do the same, not only through the pandemic, but in all circumstances we may ever face. We shall be all right if we stick with him, even if, like the disciples, we get some big surprises on the way.
Let us pray. Father, let us raise a hallelujah as we remember your Son riding triumphant on a donkey into Jerusalem. We thank you that he is the one true King, sent to save us from our sin and death. As Jesus, you wept over Jerusalem, so we have wept over the world as we know it. In Psalm 38, verse 9, in the Passion Translation, it says, Lord, you know all my desires and deepest longings. My tears are liquid words, and you can read them all. We thank you that you are with us in our suffering, our refuge and our strength, as we hide ourselves in you. We bring before you every conflict of interest causing controversy at the moment, for the asylum seeker laws, for issues with global vaccine distribution, for the policing bill, and ask for wise and peaceful resolutions. We pray for an end to violence in every form, where disregard for human life leads to the death of men, women and children. We think particularly of children shot in Myanmar and the recent mass shootings in America. We lay at your feet the ongoing COVID pandemic and its effects in so many ways on ourselves and people across the globe. Bring wisdom and understanding to all those in positions of authority. Help them to work together in an effective way to conquer this awful disease. We pray for our church family. Draw close to us this Easter time, bringing comfort and healing to our bodies and minds. Fresh hope and renewed commitment to our relationship with you, Father. Bless our outreach project of the Tree of Hope and inspire a new minister to come forward and play a part in the building up of our fellowship. Accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you for watching today's service and we hope you enjoyed it. Please feel free to check out our website and see what's on there. Just a quick reminder about our Easter services and events this coming week, both online and in the church building. Do join us to worship and celebrate together this Easter season. Now, a blessing.
Loving God, we thank you for this time we've had. Give us wisdom throughout the rest of the day and purpose to serve you. Amen.
And now the final song of worship.